Greetings, our scientist, and this is the last set of lectures for this semester. Yay! I bet if I ask you a little bit about climate change, matter of fact, I'm going to ask it now. Get out a blank piece of paper, humor me and do this, and write the first thing that comes to mind about climate and climate change. I bet you it's two words. And we'll come back and visit what those two words are in a minute, and I bet you it's not climate change. So what is the study of the Earth's climate, and how is climate different from weather? Well, that's something we've investigated, at least weather, thus far this semester. Climate is the average pattern of weather over a long duration, a period of time. So we're not just looking at temperature, we're not just looking at air pressure, we're not looking at precipitation only, wind speeds, ocean currents, cloudiness, etc. We're looking at the cumulative holistic picture. Really, Earth's climate has been measured faithfully and consistently probably for the last 50-ish or so years, with an emphasis over the last 30. Out of all the things that the climate measures, temperature by far is the most important, because it controls things like evaporation rates, drives the water cycle, deals with cloud formation, wind formation, all of which are things that help drive climate, and also ocean circulation. When you're talking about climate, you can't forget that the ocean is one of the most powerful parts of the Earth's climate. All right, let's talk about the Earth's energy budget. This is the Earth's response to balancing its temperature based on how much energy comes in and out of our atmosphere. So we get sunlight that comes in from outer space, and then some of it's reflected back. The idea is that you should have exactly the amount coming in and out. If one of those numbers is out of balance, like what goes out is more than what came in, something's up. It's less radiation going out than came in. That means you've left some behind on Earth. That's currently what's happening to us right now. And that's what this diagram represents. In your discussions for this week, this was the main topic of discussion, is how to interpret this budget. What that means. What is the energy budget, and where is that energy going? Why are we absorbing more than we're reflecting back? All right, talking more about the energy balances. Two factors that control how much solar radiation the Earth receives is two things. Here it is. Number one is the sun's output of solar radiation, and two is the distance and orientation of the sun and the Earth. The sun's output may not be constant, but it's thought to have only varied very small percentage over the past millennium. So that small percentage is not what's causing these big climatic shifts. If we get a small change in even that sun's output, that can actually alter the Earth's energy balance considerably. So slight variations can actually have substantial regional responses across the globe to the types of climate that might be experienced there. Now, you've probably heard about sunspots. We visited those a little bit during astronomy, and we talked about what sunspots do. What we really need to be focusing on is the section right around sunspots, right in here. Sunspots are dark patches on the sun, and you might expect that more sunspots would lead to less solar output. It's actually quite the contrary. Periods of time with more sunspots increase the sun's solar output and brightness, subsequently leading to more energy reaching Earth. That's not because of the hot spot itself, or should we call a sunspot, really. It's this section around it right here. It illuminates a considerably amount more heat than the actual dark sections that you see. The dark sections are actually cooler, as you learned about in astronomy. So periods of time where we have less sunspots decrease the total solar output, thus the climate can actually be cooler. These would be great test questions. The Earth's orbit also affects climate, but does on a very long-term basis, because the distance between the Sun and the Earth can vary dramatically over thousands of years. And because the Earth's orbit actually varies in its elliptical manner, it can be more circular or end up more on an eccentricity cycle like you see right here, where it's more elliptical. There is a gentleman by the name of Milutin Milankovitch who came up with a series of mathematical calculations that explain how astronomical influences can help lead to ice ages. He was trying to answer the fundamental question of why do ice ages occur on Earth? While this slight variation over even just a few years for the Earth's orbit, it may take and impact us for just a short period of time, like 100 years or a decade, these impacts, when you're looking at 100,000 year or more cycle like this one, actually have substantial impacts to long-term climate shifts on the planet. So we know that most glacial cycles last about 100,000 years, and this is in tune with Milankovitch's mathematical model that said it took about 100,000 years for the eccentricity cycle, where we are more naturally circular, and at 100,000 years, our orbit around the sun each year is very elliptical. To understand how the Earth's climate system balances the energy budget, you have to consider three things. First of all, the surface of the Earth. How much is that absorbing the energy that's coming in? What about that atmosphere where the sunlight enters the system? What's absorbed there? What's reflected back to outer space? And then what happens in the atmosphere in between those two things? Those are all important questions to ask and to look at in terms of an energy budget for any planet. So bottom line is, remember, we want an equal amount coming in and coming out. That's not happening right now, nor has it happened when we've had major glaciation periods. So instead of calling a global warming, and get your little piece of paper out I had you write, does it say global warming on it? Probably does, doesn't it? You're not alone in that concept if you wrote that down, or something about a hotter climate, it's warmer, we're in an oven, something like that. That's just not the case throughout geologic past that we only have those situations occurring. Actually, quite the contrary. We've actually had more glaciation than we have had global warmings naturally. The Earth's atmosphere keeps much of the sun's energy from escaping into outer space. That's a good thing. We actually want that to happen. And so that's called the greenhouse effect. Poor thing, greenhouse has gotten a bad rap because people want to associate it with global warming. If we didn't have the greenhouse effect, you and I would be living in igloos tenfold, and we probably would not be able to sustain life here on Earth as we know it. Right now, the atmosphere allows 50% of the sun's heat to reach the Earth's surface. About 30% is reflected back into space, and 20% is absorbed by greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. That 30 or 20%, both 30 and 20%, number two and number three. Let's look at number three more closely. That 20%, that can change. That number is subject to change based on the volume of greenhouse gases and what specific greenhouse gases we have in our atmosphere. Greenhouse gases in the atmosphere can absorb and hold some of the heat radiating back from the Earth's surface towards the outer space. If that were to happen, that means you're trapping in some of that incoming solar radiation and it can't get back out. What's the end result? A warming trend. So when you're thinking about that famous greenhouse effect, most incoming rays from the sun are in the form of visible light. Some of this energy is absorbed back by the atmosphere, reflected into outer space, and some reaches the Earth's surface. We know all of that, right? Well, energy that reaches the Earth's surface is absorbed and re-emitted in the form of lower energy, longer wavelength thermal radiation. These long wave radiations can come into very important where certain greenhouse gases are taken into effect because they absorb so much more heat. Water, carbon dioxide, and methane in particular are the number three. I guess I should put with that water, also water vapor. And we'll get to water vapor here shortly. Satellite measurements over the last 30 years have proven that long wave radiation leaving the Earth has declined at exactly the amount of wavelengths absorbed by carbon dioxide, methane, and even nitrous oxide. By the way, nitrous oxide is referred to as NOx gases. In terms of air quality regulations, We can regulate methane and NOx, but we can't regulate carbon dioxide with the Clean Air Act. That might be disturbing to you, but it's basically because carbon is so naturally occurring. Concentrations of all three of these gases have substantially increased in the same period of time as human activity really picked up since the Industrial Revolution. A term you need to know for your test is that human contributions of pollution are referred to as anthropogenic. Anthro standing for human, progenic is the source. When you think about this greenhouse effect, the overall impact of adding these gases to the atmosphere is a decrease in the amount of long-wave radiation that actually escapes back into outer space, meaning some of it gets trapped here. So that what ends up happening is the more anthropogenic sources of these greenhouse gases that absorb energy get added to the atmosphere, this causes the planet to actually increase its overall mean average temperature. In other words, have a warming. This process will increase until the amount of long wave outgoing radiation escapes through a thickened blanket of greenhouse gases and it matches. How does the Earth do that? Essentially, it compensates. Let me use an example. Let's say you get a fever. One of the first things you might do is take a fever reliever like Tylenol or Advil. And you're probably going to use cold packs because you're trying to bring down that body heat, right? Well, the Earth is going to try to do the same thing. And one way it does that is by absorbing energy and putting it into the ocean. That's one of the reasons the ocean's like the primary important factor that we look at in climate shifts. It takes that excess carbon, tries to suck it out of the atmosphere, and it stores it in rock. That rock that it makes is actually limestone. So that's a really kind of scary thing, because if the ocean changes its temperature, that limestone can begin to degrade and actually dissolve, releasing that carbon back into the atmosphere. That means you can have a runaway greenhouse effect very quickly. The atmosphere is a layer of gases that surrounds Earth and is retained by the Earth's gravity. We want this thing to happen. It warms the Earth's surface through heat retention known as the greenhouse effect. Sometimes, though, we get too many warming gases, or sometimes we don't have enough. So you have to ask yourself in climate change, what would that mean if I had not enough greenhouse gases, like I lowered the concentrations? You could end up having an ice age instead. Now, the lowest layer of the atmosphere that we have is called the troposphere. That happens to be the place that we live. There's some good and bad parts to that. While that makes up a majority of the percentage of the mass of the atmosphere, it's also where most of the pollution exists, in addition where the greenhouse gases are concentrated. So the top of this thing is usually about 18 or so kilometers above the Earth's surface, sometimes as low as 8. What that is important is that there is a layer between the troposphere and the next layer, which is a really good layer of the atmosphere that helps protect us from ultraviolet radiation. That's called the stratosphere. The stratosphere extends about 50 kilometers above the Earth's surface and captured in between the tropopause, which is right above the stratosphere, and the stratosphere itself. At the base of the stratosphere, we have something called the ozone layer. Ozone is made up of three oxygen molecules that have bonded together, and they play a role in reflecting ultraviolet radiation or absorbing it. So if you have a hole in the ozone layer, then you can reach more direct solar radiation down to the surface of the Earth. Literally half of the incoming solar radiation is absorbed by the ocean and the land surface. That can change. Let me give you a couple of scenarios. I get a very, very dark surface on the surface of the Earth because I have a whole bunch of forest. Forests are good, right? Well, if you get a bunch of dark color, that can actually absorb sunlight. The opposite would be true if I had an Earth covered with a very light substance, like a bunch of light-colored sands or glacier ice. So you can imagine during an ice age that you would be reflecting more sunlight back into space. So imagine it's like a summertime where you're wearing a black shirt, you're just heating to death if you're in Texas, And subsequently, you also wouldn't want to wear a whole bunch of white when you are in a snow environment, because you want to have some of that energy absorbed to you. The troposphere decreases the temperature with rising elevation, and the overlying stratosphere is relatively warm because the ozone retains the energy that it is absorbing from outer space. Remember I mentioned the tropopause? That's that section that exists between the troposphere and the stratosphere. This little cold layer is so important to us because it prevents water vapor from migrating into the stratosphere. Why would that be a big deal? If you get extra water vapor in there, if you remember from a few minutes ago, water vapor is a greenhouse gas, so it would absorb more temperature. So we don't want to lose that out of the troposphere. The next layer of the atmosphere is the mesosphere, and it sits on top of the stratosphere and reaches literally up to about 80 to 85 kilometers above the Earth's surface. This is where meteors come in, and they usually burn up in outer space in the mesosphere. Above the mesosphere is the thermosphere, and that makes up the little tiniest mass of the Earth's atmosphere, but that highest thickness of all the layers. That's interesting, isn't it? If we were to send a space shuttle back up there, that's where they would orbit. There's still one more layer above the thermosphere, and that's the exosphere. The exosphere is the top layer of our atmosphere, and it's the layer in which satellites orbit. So we have to talk about wind patterns in order to discuss climate, because they go hand in hand with climate situations. When warm air rises at the equator, that creates an upper limb of what we call the Hadley cycles. So if you come up and you take a look at, here's the equator right here, you're going to get some Hadley cycles right in here. And these are areas between 20 and 30 degrees north and south latitudes that have high pressure systems. So the higher the pressure that you have on Earth for an air mass, the less unequal heating of the atmosphere you have. So you should typically have clear skies, sunny, and you're not gonna have much stormy weather. AKA, this is where you'd have your world's biggest desert environment biomes. Trade winds get made right above this area and impact this region because the downflowing air from the Hadley cycles is directed towards the poles. When this occurs, Coriolis effect deflects the Hadley cells and actually causes their upper poleward limbs to deflect eastward. You can see that in this section right here. And thus their lower returning limbs flow southwards. The latter forms the trade winds, which definitely impact where we live, or right south of where we live. You have another region called the Intertropical Convergence Zone, known as the ICZ. This is created because the limb of the Hadley circulation, which is where northern and southern hemisphere trade winds meet, occur near the equator. Subsequently, you have a high evaporation rate from the ocean, high rainfall, and substantial amounts of transfer of heat from the ocean surface to the atmosphere. So you constantly have rain-like events. So they would have low pressure systems there as opposed to high pressure systems on a normal day. Now the feral cells are caused by the Hadley circulation that create a set of mid-latitude, weaker, and much less stable circulation patterns. Subsequently, you get some funky weather that happens there. When this does occur, you can get some pretty unusual weather disturbances. Cold air masses rise and sink at 30 to 40-ish degrees north and south latitude. Well, in Waco, Texas, we sit at about 31 degrees north and south latitudes. That's why we get some crazy weather here from time to time. So weather disturbances in the feral cells are important to where we live if you're anywhere in the Texas area. Polar cells occur when the dry air, the cold stuff, descends from the poles and create a high pressure region in which the downflowing air diverges towards the equator. So you get a high pressure system right up here. And when we get a weather pattern that starts to migrate down into North America, that's called a polar front, Coriolis force takes those polar cell air masses and directs the air westward in a southern wind system called polar easterlies. When they encounter the feral cells, they create a zone of unstable weather known as a polar front. Areas that can be subjected to polar fronts would be like the Pacific Northwest. Now, the jet stream is another really important aspect of climate drive. These are high-speed horizontal rivers of wind, sometimes hundreds of kilometers wide and several kilometers thick. The impact to weather occurs somewhere between the 45 degree and 60 degree mark on north and south latitudes and influence the paths of weather fronts. So if the jet stream moves further south, we'll see more of that weather. If it stays more northerly, the northern Midwestern states would receive that weather. If we didn't have this remarkable thing called the atmosphere, the layers of the atmosphere and the unequal heating of these sections of the Earth right in here, we would not have a climate. So atmosphere is just a part of it, and you have to understand the atmosphere is directly correlated to what happens on Earth. Now it's time to move into climate change drivers. So there's actually two types of drivers, just the pre-20th century and then the 20th century drivers. Climate driver, by definition, test question, is any factor that affects the movement of energy of the atmosphere. Drivers affect the climate, but they themselves are not affected by climate in any direct way. So here's a couple of examples. You get movement of planets or even Earth around the sun. You get plate movements on Earth due to plate tectonics. You get life that evolves and maybe it gives off a lot of carbon. For example, you get a swamp and a swamp material produces methane. You get a fluctuation in the Earth's orbit that could happen from a volcanic event or a natural wobbling event. You could get sunspots. Well, the sunspots themselves aren't going to experience climate change, but they certainly could on planets. Volcanic eruptions, you could get asteroid impacts. Nevertheless, each of these can play a role in causing a problem on Earth, or a positive thing. So that leads me to a new term you need to know called feedbacks. Feedbacks are any changes in the planet that are caused by climate change and then go on to amplify or dampen those climate shifts or climate changes. So they're positive and negative feedbacks. During the 20th century, the impact of human activity, anthropogenic pollution, increased tremendously. Scientific data proves this. When I worked for the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, one of our jobs was to obtain air quality monitoring data 24/7 in places that were non-attaining for the Clean Air Act. I'll give you an example. Houston, Dallas, Fort Worth would be some cities in Texas that were in that situation. The data clearly shows that these numbers are out of compliance with the federal rules, and the loading factors are enormous. And so when you start looking at that on a global perspective, you begin to see that there's a problem that we can't control. And since the Clean Air Act only impacts United States and no other country, countries across the world are voluntarily going to have to end up fighting the same fight that we are here. So the data showed us a couple of things. There's been an increase in global mean temperature. So you might see an accentuation at the pole. Well, you will actually see an accentuation, a more dramatic impact at the poles, and maybe even at the equator. It decreases the extent of snow that actually falls in the northern hemisphere, which reduces the volume of ice packs that are able to accumulate in the Arctic Circle. As the ice packs begin to melt, a global rise in sea level has occurred. At first, that didn't sound like a big deal, but it is when you consider about a quarter of the world's population lives within about 100 or so miles of a coastline. And the melting glaciers are astronomically just incredible in some areas of the world like Greenland. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, need to know who these people are for your test, by the way, they're the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. These are scientists from across the world, not just in United States or Canada, from all over the world in all fields of science, who analyze data in a non-biased way and report that about every few or so years, like the last report came out in 2013. And bottom line is they've assessed this over the past decade or so and seen a trend where anthropogenic influences to climate are substantial. So we're trying to intervene now. Unfortunately, it may be tens of hundreds of thousands of years before we see the benefits of this change. This would be a great time to take a break. Let's come back in a few minutes and finish this up on climate change. Bye.